The Bitcoin mining proof-of-work ban is rejected in EU today, but it's not over here. So I need your help now, every one of you watching. Many of the proponents of the ban mean well for sure. They just haven't understood one critical technical aspect of Bitcoin. I can assure you they haven't got it, because most people into Bitcoin haven't got it. This debate won't only come in the EU, it will be in the whole world. We will cover seven aspects today, and one of them is the most critical to understand, because it shows that the whole debate in EU now is based around a simple misunderstanding. Number one, how much carbon emission is it really? Let's take one moment to actually check the facts. I like this illustration. Here we have aviation, marine transport, air conditioners, data centers, tumble dryers, gold mining, and Bitcoin. Okay, and this one. Bitcoin's share of global energy consumption. All right, I feel that this helps get a sense of the proportion for the problem. But still, all emission is bad. Just because something else is worse doesn't mean we shouldn't do something about it, right? Let's hold that thought for a moment. We will come back to it at a later point in the video, and it will all become clear. Number two, how big is Bitcoin anyway? Does this even matter? Here someone compiled the top 20 European banks by market cap. So this is 856 billion euro. Let's not get stuck on the details, just get a feeling for the magnitude. Bitcoin market cap is over $700 billion, and in December it was over 1 trillion. So this year Bitcoin was valued by the free market to more than all of Europe's banks put together. Don't you think that banning something the size of the bank industry deserves 10 minutes of consideration before taking that decision? I think it does. Number three, is it risky? Isn't it safer to just ban this new thing and stick to what we know? Where would Europe be today if we had banned TCP/IP or GSM in the 90s? GSM, or 2G, was originally a European project. It was Groupe Spécial Mobile, GSM, in Paris. Then during my time at Ericsson, 2G became 3G, 4G, 5G, and changed the world. If you are young and mobile phones has always been there in your life, you might think it's a ridiculous thought to ban it. I can assure you it was not. There was a lot of debate that mobile phones will give everyone in Europe brain cancer and must be banned at all cost. Fortunately, the decision makers at that time decided to be pro-innovation, decided to give innovation a chance to prove itself, to prove the critics wrong. Today with Bitcoin, we're not even debating if it causes cancer. Same with the internet, it was controversial. Information is dangerous. Are we now going to hammer in the last nail in the coffin of innovation here in Europe, and from now on only live on old achievements from the golden days of the past? I think we're already doing that too much. We've gotten fat and lazy here in Europe. Here is a wake-up call if you haven't seen this chart before. Bitcoin and blockchain is the next internet, the next telecom. I can say that with certainty, I've been part of all three. But driven by whom? Bitcoin and crypto is the competition to the traditional financial industry. That much I hope is clear to everyone. Then consider how big is the bank lobbyist organizations. How much money is flowing from the traditional financial industry to the politicians? Now I don't want to point out any specific EU politician, but just look here across the Atlantic in the US.
Janet Yellen has gotten these speaking fees paid out. City National Bank, $112,000, $112,000, $112,000, Citibank, $87,000, $217,000, $217,000, Standard Chartered Bank, Credit Suisse, Citi, Goldman Sachs, Citi, Barclays, Barclays, Bank of America.
That's a total of $7.2 million. And somehow it is legal to receive this money and directly take action against Bitcoin and crypto. The competition of banks. At least exercise some critical thinking, guys. At least consider if there is another motive to some people speaking against Bitcoin. Are they really doing it from the goodness of their heart? Or is there money or favors involved? I think in many cases the real reason some people are taking this energy crisis opportunity to try to hit Bitcoin has nothing to do with their love for the environment. It's a tactic to take out the leader and symbol of this industry while still appearing to be pro-innovation. Yes, but we are pro proof of stake. It's a classic divide and conquer technique. Number five, do we even need Bitcoin? Isn't proof of work actually an aging thing of the past? I mean, there are better consensus mechanisms. Ethereum moving to proof of stake will reduce its energy consumption by 99.95%. Solana on proof of history. And there are many other great consensus mechanisms that use at least a factor 1000 less energy than Bitcoin proof of work. So do they have a point? Yes, they do have a point. I would prefer if we transition to cryptocurrencies using a factor 1000 less energy. Don't freak out now, hear me out. I was very pro moving from 2G DSM to 4G LTE. It was a better protocol. 4G delivered far more capacity, higher speed and lower power consumption. But if we had killed 2G back in the 90s, do you think there would have been a 4G used by almost everyone in the world? No, there wouldn't have. At least not our open technology that was largely driven from Europe. We might have used some other Chinese standard instead, or a Russian system, or whatever. Also, the point with Bitcoin is that it's unchangeable. It is gold. For centuries, scientists tried with alchemy to turn other metals into gold. It didn't work. Gold is what it is. It's why it has worked for so long. It just sits there, and no one can change it. That's the same thing with Bitcoin. And that's why, as of today, it's so useful as a settlement layer. Perhaps in the future, the dominating settlement layer will be something else. Perhaps not. Gold could have been replaced by something else 2000 years ago. It's still here. If anything, if we go back to this chart, we should ban gold mining before Bitcoin mining. If we ban gold and transition to this more environmentally friendly digital gold, that would be helpful for the environment. Then we try to see if we can improve it further from there. In blockchain, we're at 2G now. The first 2G deployments in Scandinavia was, I think, 1990. That's 31 years ago. Give us a couple of decades and we will be at 5G with crypto too, if we don't ban it first. Number 6. Is Bitcoin even useful? I'm based here in Sweden and I have a course with a large online process and indicator, as you know. But this is useful globally, not just here in Sweden. So we have course members from all over the world.
I offer people payment over PayPal or Bitcoin. The price of the course is $2,318. When someone pays over PayPal, first PayPal charges a fee of usually $125.24. Then PayPal offers
free withdrawals.
But when my business is in Sweden, PayPal doesn't allow me to withdraw USD, even if I set up a USD-denominated bank account at my Swedish bank. They instead insist to provide me with a free service of withdrawal with currency conversion. And coincidentally, that currency conversion happens at about 4% below the bank rate. So there I lose another $92, plus the $125.
It costs me $200 in PayPal fees to receive one payment. Sure, we could do bank transfers instead, but it's a world of pain. There's always confusion about account numbers and routing address, then it takes days for the money to arrive in best case. In worst case, it takes 3 weeks to sort out where the money got stuck.
When people pay with Bitcoin, the average fee is around $1. And you see the transfer immediately. In minutes or seconds.
So if someone says this isn't useful, well, I'm the living example that it is useful in this everyday education business I have. Moving towards a ban, where banning mining is clearly just the first step, that would be very bad for me and a million other businesses in EU. Most just haven't understood the benefits yet. I'm early on the curve. Now here comes the most important aspect of all. Latency independency. Now there is a chance that most politicians at least know some of the points 1 to 6. Though I doubt many know all of them. But this one, number 7, which is so key, I don't think anyone has really understood. If you build a data center to serve Netflix movies or Instagram pictures or bank transactions, you need to place that data center reasonably close to the sofa where your customers will sit and watch Netflix, Instagram or do the bank transaction. Otherwise, the user experience becomes really bad. So AWS, Amazon Web Services, has regions where you can configure your service. And then there is a CDN network to cache everything in your country and probably down to your city. Similarly with electricity production. Just because there is a lot of clean geothermal energy on Iceland, that electricity can't immediately be used in Netherlands if there is a shortage there. Or can it? Well, it sort of can, but it is expensive. Let me try to quantify it, at least to order of magnitude.
For example, Australia has explored this in detail. Victoria to New South Wales Interconnector West is a potential project for 2027. Price estimates is $1.3 to $1.9 billion. And we'll be able to transport another 1.8 gigawatts of capacity. So, how much is 1.8 gigawatts? Here's a list of nuclear power stations in service. 6 gigawatts, 3 gigawatts, 2 gigawatts, and so on. So this is equivalent to a mid-sized nuclear power station. And the technology to transport that electricity between two states in Australia costs about $1 to $2 billion. But what if we want to bring it even further than that? Then let's look at this project. Sun Cable, Australian to ASEAN Power Link. think. The idea is 3,750 kilometers of underwater power transmission to export electricity from Australia to Southeast Asia. The Powerlink project is a 30 billion Aussie dollar project. So it is possible to move electricity from one place to another, but it is expensive and it's difficult. Now, what does this have to do with Bitcoin? Well, the latency between the user of Bitcoin doing transactions and the data center doing the mining is not important. The block time of Bitcoin is 10 minutes, a few milliseconds here or there doesn't matter, and there's also other reasons. That means the physical location of Bitcoin mining is irrelevant. So contrary to other data centers, where latency down to a millisecond is usually super critical, you can put Bitcoin mining almost anywhere, and it's still as efficient. And because the physical location of clean energy production capacity is not matched with the physical location of clean energy consumption in the world, and that is hard and expensive to move electricity, as you just learned, you realize now where this is going. You can put the Bitcoin mining where there is ample clean energy surplus. And then this comparison that Bitcoin consumes so and so much electricity becomes irrelevant because it's not at the same place. It's like when we're feeding our kids here in Sweden and they don't eat, and you say, think of all the hungry kids in Africa, eat your food. But then the clever kid might say that, but Papa, we can't transport that spoonful of porridge to that needing child right now. Those problems of kid one not eating and kid two hungry can't be immediately cancelled out. We need to solve world hunger, no doubt, but it won't get solved by my kid eating his food. In the same way, if we ban Bitcoin mining in locations with ample clean energy, like many places in Europe, that won't solve the energy consumption need in another location, and it won't help save the planet at all. This I can guarantee that most politicians haven't understood. Now I ask you to please take two actions. First, if you find content like this useful, please like and subscribe, because the YouTube algo isn't my friend. Thank you. Number two, now you have understood this, so please write to your politicians in your jurisdiction and explain it. Here someone posted a list of EU committee members. You'll have similar lists in your country. Email works, guys. Explain it to them or send them this video if you prefer. The real problem is fear of change and fear of what we don't understand. And the solution is education. I won't be paying any politicians like the banks do, but I'm happy to come to the EU Parliament to present if it helps. Blockchain is the next internet. It is the next telecom. And I would be very sad to see my home region, EU, ban the next big technology revolutions because politicians won't take 15 minutes to educate themselves. This video is probably 15 minutes long. That's all it took. See you in this video next. Thank you, Tack. CTO Larsen out. Hej då.